inside if you want to be Jesus. Around people reading God's word, walk away and you'll miss all of heaven. Come inside and be Jesus, my Lord. Said your life had been so very cruel. You lived a life of sin, and then you said you had broken every rule. I said, oh, please don't be afraid, 'cause if you're weak, he will make you strong. Forgive all of your sin, he'll save your soul, and then you'll have brand new home. Come inside if you want to meet Jesus. Around people reading God's word, walk away and you'll miss all of heaven. Come inside and meet Jesus, not alone. Jesus, around people reading God's word, walk away and he'll miss all of heaven. Come inside and meet Jesus, my Lord. Yes, come inside and meet Jesus, my Lord.
Well, howdy. Welcome to Cowboy Church today. Glad to see you here. The band was singing about having a home on the other side. I have a question for you. Do you have a home on the other side? Yes. Well, you don't sound very excited about it. Do you have a home on the other side?
Yes.
All right. That's more better. All right. Glad to see you today. Especially want to welcome those folks who are visiting with us today. Seen several come in, first-time visitors. Others have been here a few times. We're so glad you're here. If this is your first time, would you look on the inside, top left-hand corner of your bulletin, find a section that says Welcome Neighbor. Take just a minute to fill that out. Then you can tear it off and put it in one of the containers in the back. We appreciate you for sharing that with us today. So glad that you're all here to worship with us today. Let me make mention just two or three things real quickly. Now, as you know, we are having our children's church next door. They're growing, getting more kids in there all the time. And because of that, we need some more workers. And that's a good situation to have. Ginny, come tell us about that, would you please?
Good morning, everybody. I wanted to introduce you to two of our folks. This is Tripp, and he is wearing his partial armor of God. That's what we've been working on the last month. We're going to finish it up today. And this is Walker. He's one of our puppeteers. We have a fantastic, we have probably 10 different puppets. We've got all the tools we need. We need bodies. I've created a volunteer list right up here, and Brother Dale put some back on the table behind you, but not only do we need teachers, we definitely do need teachers, but we need other folks too. Other things that we could use help with is people that would be willing to work with the puppets, people that are willing to do skits, somebody to help us with the music. We need a greeter for first things in the morning, and actually we need somebody to stay in there from, say, 10 and 10:30 in the big room while the teachers get ready for the classes. What we're going to do is we're going to start out with music from 10:30 to 10:45, and then we're going to break out back into the classes. And we need our teachers to have time to prepare. You don't have to come up with your own, as a teacher, you wouldn't have to come up with your own lessons. We'll provide everything you need for you. So if you would, grab one of these back there and consider volunteering with us. Hopefully we can get enough volunteers that we don't have to wear the same people out constantly, and we can rotate in and out. I know some people have been wondering what happened to me, because I've been over there for, what, nearly a year now. But we would really like for you to help us out, give us some of your time if you can, some of your talents. Like they always say, be careful what you ask for, or be careful what you pray for. You're liable to get it. And we did last week. We had 25, and we've only been having about 12. Then we had a water leak on top of that. It was crazy.
That's great.
But if you will, please consider helping us. I've got contact information down here, or you can leave it with Brother Dale, whatever. Thank you so much for your time.
We're going to get to do this morning the one thing that we like to do every time that we have a chance. We're going to baptize two teenagers this morning. So girls, would you come on down, please? And Don and Lily, would y'all come on down too, please? And if the families would like to come with them, they're welcome to do that as well. You recall that last Sunday we began to discuss a little bit about the baptism and the message time. And last Wednesday night, Lord planted it on Don's heart to talk some more about baptism. And as he did that, there were some girls in there who had made professions of faith in Christ, but had not followed in believers' baptism. And two of those said they were ready to do that. So our workers talked with their family that night, and they agreed, and so they're going to be baptized this morning. So, Elizabeth, would you come on up? Elizabeth Seeley, if you'd step on inside, please. Turn that way. We always like to make sure people understand being baptized is not what saves you. That's not what gets you to heaven. That happens when you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord. Both of these girls have done that. Now they're following in believers' baptism. Elizabeth, in obedience to the command of our Lord Jesus, and on your profession of faith in Him, we baptize your sister in the name of the Father and the Son, Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism, and raised to walk in new life. Okay, Alexis, come on up. This is Alexis Wilson, and her family's right down here, part of her family. And she had also prayed recently or previously to accept Christ as her Savior, and now she's following in believer's baptism. Alexis, in obedience to the command of our Lord Jesus, on your profession of faith in Him, we baptize you, our sister, in the name of the Father and the Son, Holy Spirit. Bear with Christ in baptism and raised to walk in new life. You've never followed in believers' baptism, as these young girls have. We encourage you to do that as well. It's always exciting to see people respond in obedience to the command of our Lord.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies, if you're trying to feel the same old holes inside, well, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, He's a way maker. If you need freedom, Savior, He's a prison shaking Savior. If you got chains, He's a chain. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. Well, there's a better life. there's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you've been lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, save him. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. Believing, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify.
Good morning to everybody. It's good to see all you people here. Brother Dale called me yesterday and asked me how I was doing, and I told him, I said, I want to give a testimony this morning. About 4 weeks ago, I was outside working in my garden, and I had a tiller get away from me. Well, I reached to catch it, and when I did, I stumbled and fell out of the garden on a cross tie on his right shoulder here. Immediately I had pain. Went to the house, told my wife, I said, we gotta go to the hospital. I think I broke my shoulder. So I had to call my brother to come over and get my tiller. It run off out in the yard. And he did that, went to Baptist Hospital. They x-rayed me and everything. Came in, told me, said, you don't have any broken bones, but you have a real bad dislocated shoulder. Said you need to get over to Beaumont Bone and Joint Monday and see what they got to say about it. I got up early and went to Beaumont Bone and Joint. The doctor came in and he told me, he said, you got a dislocated shoulder. He said, but you got another problem that we see on the x-ray. He said, I want you to go to have an MRI ran on your shoulder. I said, what is it? He said, there's a spot on your bone, on your forearm, and don't know what it is. Could be cancer. Well, immediately, you know how you get when you get an idea like that put in your head. So I went over to Beaumont and had an MRI ran. Went back the next day or so to Beaumont Bone and Joint, talked to the doctor in there, and the very first words he walked in, when he walked in, he said, I've got your referral started to go to MD Anderson in Houston. Well, that hit me again. He said, I don't know what it is. He said, but you need to get over and get it checked out. I said, okay. Well, I told some people here in the church, started praying for me. Our Monday night Bible class placed hands on me and prayed for me. Get over to Houston, MD Anderson. go through all the rigmarole that you have to go through to go in there. They x-rayed me again and everything. I was in there talking to one of the little nurses. She was asking me questions. She said, I need to ask you some personal questions. I said, go ahead. It was about, do you need assistance at home and all this other stuff like they ask you. Right down at the bottom of the questionnaire, she said, do you need to talk to the chaplain? I said, no, I don't. I said, I've already talked to the chaplain. I talked to his boss. I've been talking to his boss all morning. So the doctor, he came in, and he was looking at the x-rays and everything. He said, Mr. Jones, he said, I don't think you have cancer. He said, I think you've got a benign cyst that's calcified on your arm from an old injury you might have had. I said, doctor, thank God. He said, that's what I think it is. So I got to go back over in 2 months to let him x-ray me again to make sure it has not growed or anything. But I put all my faith in God, and I appreciate everybody that has prayed for me, because God's prayers do work. Amen. Do work.
Amen. A wonderful testimony there. You serve a miracle working God. That's good testimony. I really like that. Don't worry about anything. Pray about everything. Tell God what we need and thank Him for what He's done. Then we will experience God's peace. A lot to pray about today. Not to be thankful for. A lot to be thankful for. Would you please stand with me for the Pledge of Allegiance and the opening prayer? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to You this morning with thankful hearts, Lord. Thank You for this wonderful testimony that Gerald's given us this morning. Father, we just lift You up this morning, and we invite Your Holy Spirit to be here in our music and in the preaching, Lord God. Father, we pray for those that are sick at home, Lord God, or whatever, wherever they may be, Lord, that You'll just reach down and touch them this morning. Lord God, heal their bodies or meet whatever need they may have, Lord. Father, we want to pray for our children's ministry this morning, Lord God. Ginny was letting us know, Lord, what we have need of. And Father said a lot of times, but You know what we have need of before we even ask. And Father, I pray that the hearts and the people that You've prepared to work in the children's ministry, Lord God, that they'll just fill those vacancies, Lord God, and it'll be all go for Your glory, Lord God, and we thank You for that in advance, Lord. Thank You for our children's building, Lord God, and everything that You provided for us. Thank You for this building, Lord God, and our youth building, Lord God, our arena, Lord God. Help us to always be thankful for the facilities that we have, Lord. Father, we want to thank You this morning for Alexa and I'll get her name here in just a minute. Alexa and Elizabeth. Praise God. Father, we want to thank You for these two that have followed You in believers' baptism this morning, Lord, that You'll just allow Your Holy Spirit to guard and watch over them all the rest of their lives, Lord God, and order their steps, Lord, and put Your angels charge round about them, Lord. Father, pray again that You'll just bless Dale this morning as he brings the word, and bless our music also this morning, Lord Jesus. And we want to be very thankful for all the goodness and glory that You give to us, Lord God. We praise You for it. We ask all these things in the precious name of Jesus. And all of God's people said, Amen.
This is a rewrite of a Fair and Young song, if you like old country. The name of the song is Step Aside, and we're calling it Come Inside.
Spoken, and I saw You standing in a cloud of gloom. Walked right up to talk to You. You said You were leaving very soon. stopped you at your pickup truck and said, I sure hope you don't have to go. I wanna tell you about Cowboy Church, and I sure hope you don't tell me no. Come inside if you want to be Jesus. Said your life had been so very cruel. You lived a life of sin, and then you said you had broken every rule. I said, oh, please don't be afraid, 'cause if you're weak, he will make you strong. Forgive all of your sin, he'll save your soul, and then you brand new home. Come inside if you want to meet Jesus. Around people reading God's word, walk away and you'll miss all of heaven. Come inside and meet Jesus, not alone.
Since the day that I was born, there were voices that told me right from wrong. If I had listened, no, I wouldn't have gone astray. Living in love with the choices I made, I was tempted. By an early age I found I liked drinking. Oh, I never turned it down. There were loved ones, but I turned them all away. Living and dying with the choices I'd made. I've had choices since the day that I was born. There were voices that told me right from wrong. If I had to listen, no, I wouldn't have gone astray. Living and dying with the choices I'd made. For the things that I had done, things I know now. So unto the Lord I've run, I'm not losing this precious life He gave, now living and loving with the choice that I've made. I've had choices since the day that I was born. There were voices that told me right from wrong. Now I've listened, and I'm proudly here today, living and loving with the choice that I made. Yes, living and loving with the choice that I've made.
Lazarus that day, he was laid down at a rich man's gate. Somebody's darling, he was somebody's child. Once he was fair and lovely and mild. Somebody rocked him, her darling to sleep.
So long.
Well, I don't know how it happens, but the music just keeps getting gooder and gooder. I really appreciate our band and our soloist who sing from time to time. They always do an excellent job. I love them and appreciate them very much. Mark, thank you for that song. I'm not sure if I'd heard that before, but I sure did like it. Said when Jesus, they thought, was 4 days late, but he was still right on time. Pastor I had when I was in college used to say time and time again, God never hurries, but he's never late. He's always right on time. I'm very thankful for that. Last week, we began our study in the Gospel of Mark, and we will continue that today. Let's do just a very quick review of what we looked at last week to get us all on the same page. We said that Mark is the shortest of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and was probably the first one written. Mark was writing to a Roman audience, and the Romans loved action, and the action never stopped in Mark's Gospel. It just kept going. The opening chapters and really the whole book moved at a very fast pace as they recounted the ministry of Jesus. Mark's storyline moved very quickly from beginning to end and shows the no time to waste action that Jesus had in his life and ministry. Like a fall cattle drive in the Old West, there was always a sense of urgency to get her done, to move on and to move on to the next phase. And that's the way the book of Mark is. Last week, we looked in chapter 1 at verses 1 through 8. There we saw that Mark didn't take time to talk about shepherds and wise men and angels. He moved right in to talking about the Lord, about his coming as the Messiah. He began by focusing on John the Baptist, who was to prepare the way for the Lord. And then he talked about Jesus as he began his ministry. Remember, we talked about John and said that he was a pretty strange character. He wore clothes that were made out of camel's hair, and he ate wild honey and locusts. But God used him to preach a very powerful message about repentance and confession and baptism. And God used him in a very powerful way. Many people responded to him and were saved and baptized. Mark said that John preached that people should be baptized to show that they had been forgiven and turned to God for forgiveness. He was very effective in doing this. Many people responded. The one thing about John that we really need to point out is this. John never pointed to himself. He never called attention to himself. He always pointed to the Lord as the Messiah, always. And that's what we need to do today as well. Now, let's move on to our study for today. And in chapter 1, we'll begin right now in verses 9 through 11. Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. Mark said, one day Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee, and John baptized him in the Jordan River. As Jesus came up out of the water, he saw the heavens splitting apart and the Holy Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice from heaven said, you are my dearly loved son, and you bring me great joy. Here in verse 9, Mark mentioned the city Nazareth. You may recall that that was the small town where Jesus grew up. It was located in the northern province of Galilee. It's estimated that at that time, Nazareth had a population probably of about 400 people. Today, there are over 77,000 people who live in the city of Nazareth, and most of them are Muslims. It was from that little town of Nazareth that Jesus walked some 50 miles or more to get to the Jordan River where John baptized him. That's where Jesus was baptized. That's where his ministry began. It's really where Mark's story began. Later on in chapter 6, Mark talked a little bit more about Jesus personally, pointed out that he had been a carpenter, talked just a little bit about his family, not much. If Mark were the only gospel that talked about Jesus, we'd know very little about his life before his ministry. Mark just didn't talk about that. He went right to his ministry, to his preaching and teaching. Jesus, I think, likely went to John to be baptized because he wanted to identify with John's ministry. He wanted to be baptized by John. John had preached repentance and confession and then baptism. That's the message that Jesus was going to be preaching. Jesus, I think, wanted John to baptize him for that very reason. Jesus would be the completion of what John and all the prophets had talked about. He would be the fulfillment of all that God had been doing with the people of Israel all the way up until this time. In these verses right here, 9 through 11, Mark talked about the baptism of Jesus. We talked some about that last week. We'll talk more about it again today. By some definitions, the word baptism, or to baptize, means to dip. The Greek root word means to immerse, to plunge, or to sink down in the water. Now, if you notice there how Mark described the baptism of Jesus, he said Jesus came up out of the water. Now, the only way that he could do that is if he had been down in the water, first of all. He has to be down in the water to come out. That tells us, I think, very clearly that Jesus was baptized by immersion, just the way that we did these two young ladies today. They were put under the water and then came up. That's the way that we baptize at the Cowboy Church. Some churches do it differently. That's the way that we do it. In those days, baptism by immersion was a part of the Jewish tradition. Very often, Gentiles who converted to Judaism would be baptized by immersion to show that they had become a part of that new religion for them. John's baptism was not becoming part of a new religion or a new faith. His was a baptism of repentance and faith, and Jesus' baptism that he would preach would be the same thing. Now, if John's baptism was for repentance, then there's a logical question that we need to ask. Why did Jesus need to be baptized? John was preaching repentance and confession. Jesus had nothing to repent of. He had never sinned. The Bible makes that very clear. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, Paul said, "For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, that we might be made right with God through Christ." Christ never sinned, so he had no need to repent. So why was he baptized? I think there are several reasons. First of all, I think Jesus was using his baptism to officially begin his ministry. It was time for that to begin to take place. He was going to share the message of salvation with all people. I think also through his baptism, Jesus identified with the people he'd come to save. I think, though, the main reason, the primary reason that Jesus was baptized was to set the example for all of us. Jesus was baptized. He called all of his followers to be baptized, and he showed them how to do it. He said, "You've seen me do it. Now this is what I want you to do as well." I think today when you and I are baptized, after we accept Christ as our Savior, we are identifying with Christ, the one who came and gave his life for us. We are following in his footsteps and being obedient to him. The Bible teaches us very clearly that every believer should be baptized after becoming a believer in Jesus Christ. Baptism marks the beginning of a new life. As we've already said, Jesus didn't need to repent, but he used his baptism to begin his new life. He was ending his career as a carpenter and was about to begin his preaching and teaching ministry. This was showing a change, a turn in his life. By the same token, when you and I are baptized, we are publicly announcing to the world that our life is taking a different turn. We're going a new direction. We have a different emphasis. We're putting the old life without Christ behind us. Now we're moving forward with him in our lives. He is our Lord and Savior, and we are not ashamed of it. We want the world to know that he has saved us, and now we are walking with him. And let me say this. As soon as we are saved, we need to follow in believer's baptism. I know sometimes there are instances where a person cannot be baptized immediately, but I believe he should do it as soon as possible. The New Testament is full of accounts of people who were saved, they received salvation, and then they were baptized immediately. They didn't wait. If you have never been baptized, we challenge you and encourage you to do that. Now, in some ways, Jesus' baptism was like the others that were taking place in that day. But there were also some differences. In a very important way, Jesus' baptism was very different from the others at that time. When Jesus was baptized, the Holy Spirit came down and the Father in heaven spoke. Mark said that the Holy Spirit descended on Jesus like a dove coming down. The heavens came open. The Spirit came down. And then the Father from heaven spoke and said to Jesus, "You are my dearly loved Son, and you bring me great joy." Wouldn't you like to have been there that day when Jesus was baptized and see the Spirit coming down? The heavens were opened. The Spirit came down. And to hear the Father audibly speaking to Jesus and saying, "You're my dearly loved Son, and you bring me great joy." Can you just imagine what an experience that would have been? Jesus was beginning his ministry at this point. I think it's important for us to note right here in the verse that we just read, Mark talked about all three members of the Trinity being present: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Jesus was the one obviously being baptized. The Holy Spirit came down and the Father spoke. All three of the members of the Trinity were present at that time. John had been preaching, saying, "One is greater than I am, is coming, and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Now the Spirit is there. Jesus will continue to preach that as well. Jesus' baptism showed that he was, in fact, the Messiah. And as the Father and the Holy Spirit were there, they affirmed that as well. Now let's read verses 12 and 13. "The Spirit then compelled Jesus to go into the wilderness, where he was tempted by Satan for 40 days. He was out among the wild animals, and the angels took care of him." Now, why did Jesus, immediately after his baptism, go out into the wilderness by himself? He had just had this very important experience. He was just baptized. Now he goes out into the wilderness with no one else around. Why did he do that? Did Satan persuade him to go out there so he could tempt him? No, Mark made it very clear. He said the Spirit compelled Jesus to go into the wilderness. It wasn't Satan. The Spirit did this, knowing that Jesus was going to be tempted by Satan for 40 days. Now, sometimes you and I will go through a similar situation. We may have a very rich, meaningful, religious experience. We may be on the mountaintop spiritually. Then all of a sudden, Satan comes and attacks us. He tempts us. He wants to lead us astray, get us off of that mountain, and bring us back down into the valley. He will attack us in every way that he can. But the Spirit compelled Jesus to go out there, knowing what was going to take place. This was all part of God's plan. God wanted Jesus to go through this. You see, this was one of the clearest ways that Jesus identified with mankind, was by being tempted from Satan. But Jesus never gave in. He never yielded to temptation. He remained sinless all of his life. Hebrews 4:15 says, "He understands our weaknesses, for he faced all of the same testings that we do, yet he did not sin." Because Jesus went through temptation, because he never gave in and sinned, he knows what it's like for us. And because of that, he can help us overcome temptation as well. He is our helper we can depend on. He shows us the example, not only of being baptized, but how to go through temptation and resist by trusting the Holy Spirit to lead us through those times. Now, we need to understand something about Satan. There are many people who do not believe that Satan is a real individual, a real being. Many think that if ever he had been real and alive, he is no longer. Folks, we need to understand Satan is very much real and alive. He is not the figment of somebody's imagination. He is not symbolic. He is real, and he is constantly working against God and all those who obey God. Satan was an angel who rebelled against God. That's why he got kicked out of heaven. Now he spends all of his time trying to tempt people to turn away from God, just like he did. We might need to stop and think, when was the last time that we ran head on into Satan? When was the last time that he really worked on us, tempting us to do something to lead us away from what God is calling us to do? I've said before, I heard somebody say one time years ago, the only time that we don't run head on into Satan is when we're going the same way he is. If Satan is not attacking you, you might not look and see which way you're going. You may be going the same way that he is. Again, Hebrews says, Jesus faced all these temptations for us. He knows our weaknesses, and because of that, he can help us go through those times. You recall that Satan tempted Eve in the Garden of Eden. She ate of the forbidden fruit. She sinned, as did Adam. Then Jesus attacked Satan tempted Jesus in the wilderness. But Jesus did not give in to that temptation. Understand that being tempted is not a sin. Giving in to that temptation is a sin. Now let's look at verses 14 and 15. Mark went on to say that later on, after John was arrested, Jesus went into Galilee where he preached God's good news. The time promised by God has come at last, he announced. The kingdom of God is near. Repent of your sins and believe the good news. Some of you are horse owners. If you have a particular horse that you want to show in whatever discipline, he may have all the registration papers that show that he has the potential to be a world champion. But you're not going to show that horse until he's ready. Jesus himself, so far in our study for today, had committed to a new life following his baptism, and then he confronted the temptations that came with that new life. After these two things took place, then he was ready to begin his preaching and teaching ministry. But not until then. We can go back to the other gospel accounts that say, in the fullness of time, or when the time was right, Jesus came and was born. Here, when the time was right, Jesus began his preaching and teaching ministry. Everything that God does is right on time, just as we said earlier about the song that Mark sang. Now was the time God had predetermined for Jesus to begin preaching and teaching. Mark said that after John was arrested, Jesus began this ministry. In this chapter, Mark doesn't talk about the sufferings of Jesus, of John. Maybe his readers were already aware of it. But later in chapter 6, Mark will talk about all that John went through. Here, Mark said that Jesus went back to Galilee, back to Nazareth, and began preaching and teaching. Now, John had preached a word of warning about what was to come. Jesus took a little bit different approach, and he brought the good news about God's kingdom. This was probably a welcome relief to those people who had been listening to John. They had to be encouraged to hear that the coming of God's kingdom was full of grace, not just condemnation. Now, the good news that Jesus preached was very simple. It was clear, easy to understand. Jesus made it clear that the crucial moment and God's timing for salvation had come. It had arrived. All of history had been leading up to this time. The call of Abraham, the exodus from Egypt, the time of the judges, the preaching of the prophets, all these other things that took place led up to this particular moment in time when the Messiah would appear. And Jesus was saying to the people, I am that Messiah. I am coming to fulfill what has been promised all of this time. He was that long-awaited Savior. Now, as you know, the people in his day, the Jewish people, had been looking for someone to come and free them from Roman domination. But that wasn't the reason that Jesus came. His kingdom was totally different from what they were expecting. His wasn't a political kingdom. It wasn't a military kingdom. It was a religious kingdom. It wasn't of this world, but it was now beginning to invade this world. This is the good news that Jesus preached. He announced to them a change of direction in their lives. Jesus also preached a message of repentance, turning around, going the opposite direction, just as John had preached as well. And when Jesus preached, he called the people to live a different kind of life than what they'd been living before. He called them to live a life of love, mercy, sacrifice, and forgiveness. All of these values were completely opposite of what the people back then were living, and they are completely opposite of our society today as well. Finally, the good news that Jesus preached called people to put their trust in him. He preached that faith in the gospel will lead to salvation. Instead of looking for a political Messiah, they should be looking for God to provide grace through the coming of his kingdom, and that's exactly what happened. God was offering salvation through Jesus, and Jesus was calling them to listen to God, to come to him for salvation, to place their faith and trust in him. When we read the rest of Mark's gospel and the other three gospels as well, we see that the rest of Jesus' ministry, all of his preaching and teaching, goes back to the same thing that he preached and taught right here at the very beginning of his ministry. The miracles he performed, the lessons he taught, his sacrifice on the cross, his victory over the grave, all of these things point to exactly who he was, the divine Son of God. He was the Messiah, the anointed one, the long-awaited Savior. And as Simon Peter would say later on, he was the Christ, the Son of the living God. In our passage for today, we've seen the two major events in Jesus' life, his baptism and his temptation. Through these two events, Jesus identified with mankind. He identified with you and me, showing us what we need to do. He set the example for us to follow. In his baptism, he set the example. In his temptation, he set the example that we can be tempted, but we can resist those temptations through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now he expects us to follow those two examples. If you have never followed in believer's baptism, I challenge you to consider that. If you have accepted Jesus Christ recently, or maybe many years ago, if you have never followed in believer's baptism, Jesus calls you to do that. We have preached ever since we've been here that God blesses obedience. When you follow in obedience, God will bless you for doing that. Not only will you be blessed when you're baptized, but whenever we see somebody being baptized right here, we are blessed. It's probably the most exciting part of our service, to see a person follow in believer's baptism. If you've never done that, don't rob yourself. Don't rob other people of that blessing. Then by the same token, just as Jesus resisted temptation, you can do that too. Now, you can't do it on your own, so don't try it. But through the power of the Holy Spirit, you can resist any temptation that Satan throws in front of you. Bible says if we will resist Satan, he will flee from us. He will leave us alone temporarily. Understand, he will come back. Don't expect him to be gone for very long. He will do everything that he can to blindside you, to catch you when you're least expecting it. When you think things are going well, you better get ready. Something's fixing to happen. You got to be ready for him. He wants us to be baptized. He wants us to resist temptation. That's our challenge for today. Would you commit right now as an individual person to do those two things? Understand that it will be for your benefit and for God's glory. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for the truth of your word. Thank you for the coming of your Son, the Messiah, to be our Savior and Lord. Thank you that he was willing to identify with us through his baptism and temptation. Now, Father, it's our prayer that you would help us to follow his example. Lord, to first accept him as Savior and then follow his example of being baptized and then resisting temptation so we can be what you've called us to be. Father, for anyone here who's never trusted Christ as Savior and Lord, I pray right now that before this service is over, before they leave, they would open their hearts and lives and invite Jesus to come in as Savior and Lord. Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit would do his work of convicting and convincing right now of sin and righteousness and judgment. Father, we ask you to speak to our hearts right now as Jackie begins to play. Would you evaluate your own heart and life right now? Do you know that there was a particular time, a moment, when you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord? If that's never happened, would you do it today? Would you acknowledge that Jesus is God's Son? He died on a cross and raised again. Would you invite him into your heart and life? You can do that by praying a simple prayer, something like this. But understand, you word it any way that you want to. God knows your heart. You might say, God, I know I'm a sinner, and I'm sorry for my sins. God, I ask you today to forgive me of every sin in my life. I know that Jesus is your Son. He died on a cross and was raised again. And now, Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart, into my life, and be my Savior and Lord. And with all the faith I have right now, I open my heart and life. And Jesus, I accept you as my personal Savior and Lord. I want to follow you from this day forward. If you prayed a prayer similar to that and really meant it from your heart, God's word tells us that he heard your prayer and answered it and saved you. You want to give him thanks for that. If you've already accepted him and not been baptized, would you commit to that? Is there another decision that God is leading you to make today? Whatever it is, would you be willing? Would you commit yourself to a life of total obedience? Let's spend just a few moments in silent prayer, asking God's Spirit to speak to our hearts and make his will known for us, our individual lives, our families, and our church. All right, if you made any decision today, we're very grateful for that. You may have been saved. You may have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. We're thankful for that. You may have decided to be baptized, to join the church, or whatever other decision you've made. There are some green sheets on the table back there in the corner. I invite you to pick one of them up and fill that out. Let us know about your decision. We'd like to visit with you about that even before you leave today. Thank you for being here today. Hope to see you again this coming Sunday. Would you stand there for a closing prayer?
Our Heavenly Father, we come to you today thanking you for being here with us. We thank you for being our Heavenly Father. And Lord, we just pray if there's anyone here that doesn't know you, that they would stop someone or ask you to come into their heart. Father, help us to always show people what a changed life you can make in us. We thank you for each part of the service this morning. We thank you for the youth workers, the children's workers. Just pray that someone will step up and want to help with the children's workers. And Father, we thank you for the youth workers who guide these two ladies to know that they need you in their heart. Father, it changes our lives, and we thank you for that. Go with us now as we leave. Protect us, lead, guide, and direct us, and be with us in everything we think, say, and do. For it's in thy name we pray. Amen. Amen.